All right. A person pushes a 14.5 kilogram lawnmower at a constant speed. That constant speed is very important. Right? Constant speed means the acceleration in the x direction is zero. Obviously, acceleration in the y is also zero. So, you know, that's kind of, I don't think this lawnmower is going to be levitating off or going through the ground, right? So the acceleration, both x and the y, can be considered as zero. All right, so a force of 88.0 newtons is directed along the handle. So this force is acting directly down this way, okay? At the angle of 45 degrees to the horizontal. So first, draw a free body diagram, right, showing all forces acting on the lawnmower. All right, so let's take a look at the lawnmower. Assume that dot is the lawnmower, right? So we're going to have 88 newtons of force acting straight down at 45 degree angle, okay? So if I were to draw my axis, all right, so here is force push, okay? So F push. That's the 88 newtons right there, right? So this is aimed at 45 degree angle. So this can be broken up into its X and Y components. So we've got F push Y, right? So F push Y, and then you have F push X component going horizontally. F push X. Okay. So this, once I break them up into their its components, we will use just the components in the X and Y axis direction. Then we also have 14.5 kilogram lawnmower. So we have FG going straight down. And that is equal to M times G. And we have F normal. Now I know I drew that a little bigger than FG here, and you'll see why later. I exaggerated that just to make a point. Then there's definitely some kind of resisting force, okay, resisting force like friction going in the opposite direction of motion. We're going to call that friction, okay? All right, so that's part A, actually. Okay, that's part A. For part B, calculate the horizontal retarding force on the mower. I don't like that word right there, but I mean, it's not a bad word, but they could have used different wording, I think. All right, so it's sort of like a resisting force on the lawnmower, right? So that is basically, you know, friction. That's friction, right? So the horizontal friction force in the lawnmower. So let's calculate that. Well, we know this F push itself is 88 newtons, right? So if we were to calculate the F push Y and F push X, well, F push X is F push times cosine of, right, 45 degrees. So if that's true, F push, which is 88, times cosine of 45. And that is, let's see what that is. So 88 times cosine of 45 degrees. That's 62.2, okay? And since this is 45 degrees, and this is X hat, I guess, right? And since this is 45 degrees, the Y component should be the same as well, right? 62.2. However, don't forget, this is pointing in the negative Y direction. But we'll give direction later, okay? We'll give direction later. So for part B, sum of all forces in the X direction is equal to MAX. Then, sum of all forces in the X direction is equal to, well, I have two forces in the X direction, here, this, and this, right? So, F push X, and I have friction as well, right, in the X direction. Well, since I can set these two equal to each other, then MAX is equal to, now F push X, I'm going to call that positive, right, because that's the direction of motion, right, minus friction. So here, my MAX, A is zero, so my F push X minus friction is equal to zero. So if I bring this negative friction to the other side of the equal sign, it becomes positive. My friction then is equal to just F push X, which happens to be 62.2 newtons. So my frictional force is also equal to 62.2 newtons. All right? Now, obviously, this friction has to be the same as this because the acceleration is zero, okay? And we just proved that right here. All right, what about part C? The normal force exerted vertically upwards on the motor, or the lawnmower, right? So for part C, now we're looking for sum of all forces in the Y direction is equal to MAY. And then we could say sum of all forces in the Y direction is equal to, well, there are 1, 2, 3 forces, right? I have F normal plus FG, right? Plus FPY. So I have these three forces in the Y direction. So now I can set these two equal to each other. MAY now is equal to F normal. I'm going to consider the up direction positive. Therefore, F normal is positive. FG is pointing down. Therefore, it's negative. And F push Y is also pointing down. So that's also negative. We know AY is equal to 0. So 0 is equal to F normal minus FG, which is MG, right? So what is FG? Well, FG is equal to 14.5 times 9.8. Right? So it looks like we could say 14.5 times 9.8, and I get 142.1. Right. Minus FPY. So if I solve for F normal by bringing these two to the other side of the equal sign, right? My F normal then becomes, right? FG plus FPY. Therefore, my FG 142.1 plus 62.2 is equal to my F normal. Now, be careful here. I know this is pointing in the negative direction, but I kept this as positive. Because I gave direction here as negative, okay, I'm not going to put another negative 62.2 in here. Then this negative times this negative will come out to be positive. So you only give this direction once and use the positive magnitude value into this FPY. All right, so that's very important. So what is my F normal then? My F normal then is equal to I guess these two added together, which is 204.3 newtons. So that's my part B, or part C, I should say. All right. So the force person must exert on the lawnmower to accelerate it from rest to 2.5 seconds, assuming the same frictional force. Okay? Assuming the same frictional force. I guess I don't like this word, retarding. Okay. All right. Well, that means I'm going to have to make this, right, bigger to overcome friction horizontally to make it accelerated at this much. Now, this is from rest to this in this many seconds. So we have to figure out what the acceleration is. All right. So first, let's calculate what the acceleration is. So here, in part D, I'm going to need more room. I drew this way too big. Part D, we know initial velocity is zero because it starts from rest. Then we also know VF is equal to 1.5 meters per second. And we know T is equal to 2.5 seconds. We're looking for what the acceleration is. Okay? Well, once we find the acceleration, then we can actually figure out what the net force is, right, in the x direction. So here, my acceleration is equal to change in v over change in t. Therefore, vf minus vi over t, right? Change in t is just t if the initial t is zero. Therefore, 1.5 minus 0 over 2.5 is my acceleration. So what is my acceleration? Well, my acceleration then is equal to, I get 0.6 meters per second squared as my acceleration. Now this acceleration obviously is in the x direction, okay? Now, once I know that, I can actually figure out what my acceleration is. And I have to redo this now with acceleration being this. So it's no longer zero anymore. So let's continue the part D here, okay, at the top. I'm sorry, I'm running out of room. So here for part D, right, sum of all forces in the x direction is equal to max, and sum of all forces in the x direction is equal to, okay, I have F push x again, right? And then I have friction as well. But we know these values for friction, right? We know the value for friction already because they want us to keep using the same value. Okay. But this will change, obviously, because you're increasing your force this way. You're increasing your force going down this way, which will also increase the x horizontal component of that. So max is equal to F push x, which we don't know yet because this is a new F push x, but it's going to be positive direction, minus friction. We're going to keep the same value as friction that we calculated, which is 62.2. So this is 62.2. So here, my mass, which is 14.5 times acceleration, which is now 0.6, is equal to F push X minus, right, 62.2. So what's my F push X? So my F push X is equal to, well, this times this plus 62.2 is what we have to do, I guess, right? So this becomes 8.7 is equal to, well, plus 62.2, right, is equal to my FPX, okay? So my FPX now becomes 70.9 newtons. Well, if my FPX is equal to 70.9 newtons, and that is the horizontal component, right? So that's FPX. Well, what must my FP have to be to produce that 70.9? So this is my new F push, right? And this angle here is 45 degrees. So that looks like, right, FPX over cosine is equal to FP, right? So FP is equal to FPX divided by cosine of 45. So what's my FP, my new FP? My new FP is equal to 70.9 divided by cosine of 45. So my new FP is equal to 100.3 newtons as my new F push. Okay. I hope you can follow that. All right. Any questions? All right, good. Moving on. All right, let's take a look at number two. If the coefficient of kinetic friction between 35 kilogram crate and the floor is 0.3, what is the horizontal force that is required to move the crate at a steady speed across the floor? Again, look at that, steady speed, right? Steady speed means my acceleration is equal to zero, Okay. So, what horizontal force is required if mu sub k is zero? Well, then we'll worry about that later. That's part B. But for now, let's take a look at what it's going to look like if I had a floor here and I have a crate. All right, so this crate, it has friction between the floor and the crate. And mu sub k happens to be 0.30 between the crate and the floor. Okay? Now they're asking how much horizontal force is required to move that thing at a constant speed. So here is the F force applied. I'm going to say FA, force applied. This could be force push, force pull, right? Apply force, basically. Well, what's countering that? Well, there's something countering that, and that is basically my force friction. It's countering that. And of course we have FG, as well as F normal. Right? Well, we know I guess there's two ways you could go about doing this. Let's just figure out what that friction is. Then that's what we're going to have to apply to get this thing moving at a constant speed, right? Because they have to equal to each other. So if we could figure out, you know, what that friction is, then we're pretty much done. So let's take a look at what these values may be. Well, first of all, FG, we know what that is, right? That is MG, and that is 35 times 9.8. So my FG is equal to 343 newtons. Since there are no other vertical forces acting on this, unlike here, my F normal and my FG are going to be the same values, right? Except they're pointing in the opposite direction of each other. So I'm going to say 343 newtons for my F normal. I mean, if you want me to, I can actually do the sum of all forces in Y is equal to MAY, and the sum of all forces in Y is F normal plus FG, and then set them equal to each other, but AY is zero, so F normal minus FG is equal to zero, and F normal is equal to then FG, and boom, boom. All right? So you should be able to write that out if you're not sure about it. All right, then however, let's take a look in the X direction now. So sum of all forces in the X direction is equal to MAX, okay? And sum of all forces in the X direction, I have F applied plus FG, right? No, F friction, right? So here, MAX is equal to force applied minus F friction. And since acceleration is zero, right? Zero is equal to then FA minus friction, which is mu times the F normal, right? So my FA is equal to, if I bring this to the other side, becomes positive. So mu times the F normal is my FA, which is my friction right here, right? So my FA, the force applied, has to be same as my friction, which is 0.3 times my F normal, which happens to be 343. So the force applied has to be, right, 102.9. Sounds like a radio station, but that's what it is. 102.9 newtons have to be applied in order to make this thing go steady at no acceleration at constant speed. All right. So for part B, what if the horizontal force is required? What horizontal force is required if mu sub k is zero? Well, for part B then, since we know FA, you know, has to equal to mu times F normal, if mu sub k is zero, then FA is not required to keep it going at all.
Mr. Kim, can you move your paper over a little bit?
Yep, I can. Sorry.
Thank you.
Sure. So if FA is equal to mu times F normal, if my mu sub k is equal to zero, my FA is also zero. So we don't need any force to keep it going if there's no friction. Okay? I mean, if you want me to write the, you know, the sum of all force in y is equal to my here, and then sum of all force in y is equal to fg, right, plus f normal. So my is equal to, right, negative fg plus f normal, ay is zero. So, right, f normal is equal to fg, right, which is equal to 343 newtons. Right. I might as well write that down. All right. All right, good. Any questions? All right, then. Moving right along. All right, number three. A force of 40 newtons is required to start 5-kilogram box moving across the horizontal concrete floor. A, what is the coefficient of static friction between the box and the floor? B, if 40 newtons of force is continued, the box accelerates it this much, because there's going to be two different coefficient of frictions. One static, one kinetic. Static happens when box is not moving. And then kinetic happens when box actually starts to move, right? So there are two scenarios happening, okay? So I'm gonna draw two boxes. However, it's same box, it's okay? And I'm just drawing it in two scenarios so that we can see one that's moving versus one that is stationary, okay? So here, 40 newtons of force is required to get this box moving. So here, if I were to push on this thing, right? So force push or force pull, it doesn't matter. At 39.999 newtons. It's not moving, right? 39.999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999 40 newtons on the dot, this thing starts to budge, which means technically it's still at rest, but it's going to start to move. Okay? So what's holding that back? Well, static friction is holding that back. Okay? So this friction and this F pull or F push, they have to be the same. Okay? So here we can say my F friction in this case, it's still 40 newtons at this instant. Okay? So my friction has to be same value as my F push. Well, how do we say that? Well, sum of all forces is equal to, right? MAX, and sum of all forces in the X is equal to, I have F push, right, plus F friction. And if I set them equal to each other, MAX is equal to F push minus F friction. Okay, acceleration in the X is 0 at that moment. So my F push minus F friction. So my frictional force, if I bring that to the other side, is equal to my F push, which happens to be 40 newtons. Now, my friction is also equal to mu sub s times F normal. Well, what's my F normal? Well, here, Fg is going this way. My F normal is going that way. And since there are no other vertical forces acting on this, my F normal, again, is equal to Fg in this case. Right? So since my Fg is equal to 5 times 9.8, it is 49 newtons. That means my F normal is also equal to 49 newtons. So are we okay with that? I hope so, right? So my friction, which we calculated to be 40 newtons, is equal to mu sub s times F normal, which is 49 newtons. So my mu sub s is equal to 40 divided by 49. So what's my mu sub s? I get 0.8216 as my mu sub s. Now this thing is moving, it's accelerating, right? This thing is accelerating. Maybe I should redraw this like here. So here, let me just redraw that here. Now moving, okay? So here we have not moving, okay? Here we have moving. Okay. And we're going to still apply 40 newtons of force. So F applied force push or force pull is equal to 40 newtons still, right? But this time, because it is moving, we're going to actually have, right, kinetic friction. This time it is moving, so it is kinetic friction. Here is a static friction, right? And we still have Fg and F normal. Oops, sorry. Sorry for poking you in the eye. All right, so here we have F normal and we have Fg. They don't change vertically, okay? So here we have 5 times 9.8 again, so it's 49 newtons. And F normal, again, there's no other vertical forces acting on it. Therefore, F normal and Fg are equal to each other in this case. So this time, because my friction is actually in kinetic friction, it's going to be lower value than my static, and 40 newtons is greater than this, so it's going to actually have a net force going that direction, so it's going to make it accelerate it at this acceleration. So utilizing the same equation, okay, so here, if we say sum of all forces in the x direction is equal to max, this is not zero anymore, this is 0.7 now, okay? And sum of all forces in the x direction is equal to F push plus friction. Right. So max is equal to F push positive minus F friction. So here I have 5 times 0.7 is equal to F push is 40 minus F friction. So if I bring this to the other side, it becomes positive. This 3.5, if I bring this to the other side, becomes negative. So my friction is equal to 40 minus 3.5. Okay? And that is 36.5 newtons. All right. So my friction happens to be 36.5 newtons. Therefore, since my friction is equal to mu sub k, this time is moving, so it's mu sub k, times the F normal, my friction, which is 36.5 now, is equal to mu sub k times 49. So my mu sub k is equal to 36.5 divided by 49. So my mu sub k is equal to, right, I get 0.745 as my mu sub k. So notice, it is smaller than my mu sub s. All right, I hope everybody got that. All right, any questions? Let's move on to number four. A box sits at rest on a rough 30-degree inclined plane. Draw the free body diagram showing all the forces acting on the box. All right. Well, I think we have to learn how to draw the free body diagram of this, John. Okay. All right. So here, I guess we're going to have three different scenarios, right? We're going to have one at rest, one sliding down, and one sliding up. I think we did very similar thing like this before, right? In your note packet. All right, so we're going to have boxes here. So this first one is at rest, okay? So I guess I'm going to have to draw the horizontal lines for my incline. So this is at rest. Since it's at rest, I'll do it in red. And this is sliding down. And this is sliding up. So four, at rest. We know we're going to have FG. Whether it's at rest, sliding down, or sliding up, it doesn't matter. We have our FG. And we have F normal. F normal. And F normal. Whether it's sliding up, sliding down, or at rest, it doesn't matter. Our normal forces will always be there. Now, this FG can be broken up into its components of FGY and FGX. So here's my FGX, and here's my FGY. Again, it does not matter whether it's at rest, sliding up, or sliding down. It does not matter. We will always have my FGX pointing down the incline, right? My FGY will be in the opposite direction of my F normal. And again, here, FGX will always point down the incline, no matter what. Now, What's holding this, right? What's holding this thing from sliding? What force is keeping it up on the incline? That would be friction. That is same value as my FGX. Okay, so here, this is my friction that's holding this thing up, so it is canceling out my FGX. Okay, so here at rest, my F friction is equal to my FGX. Here, my FGX is positive, and my F friction is negative. When it's sliding down, my friction's not big enough to hold it up there, so it's going to be moving, so it's a kinetic friction. And this kinetic friction is definitely going to be less than my FGX, obviously, right? So my friction here is definitely less than my FGX. And my FGX is going to be positive because it is the direction of motion. And my F friction will be negative. For this, I'm going to indicate the direction of motion, I guess. Well, direction of motion for this, obviously, is straight down the incline, so that's going to be my positive direction. But the direction of this is kind of hard to tell, but I'm going to call the direction of its intended motion to be positive. And since it's going to intend to go down, if I were to just release this, I'm going to still call the down the incline positive. However, for this one, the direction of motion is up the incline because it's sliding up. So I'm going to call the up the incline to be positive direction because that's the direction of motion. And my friction is going to be acting in the opposite direction of motion. Therefore, it'll be down the incline like so. So my frictional force, we don't know if this is going to be bigger than this, it's going to be less than this, or equal to this. But we know the friction has to point down the incline because that's the opposite direction of motion. So we cannot tell whether friction is bigger, smaller, or equal. But however, I do definitely know that my FGX is negative because it's pointing down the incline, right? And my friction is also in the negative direction. So they're both negatives here. But we don't know whether the friction is bigger, smaller, or equal. Okay? This is very important, this concept. Okay? Now, if this angle here is 30 degrees, then this angle here is also 30 degrees. If this angle is 30, this angle is 30. 30. 30. Okay, maybe we should write that in there. So here, 30 degrees. This is 30 degrees. We proved that, so you can use it. You don't have to keep proving it. Right? This is also 30 degrees. Here, 30 degrees. This, 30 degrees. Okay? Practice drawing that, especially that little triangle. Always start out with FG going straight down, right? I see people like draw the FG this way and then like FGY going off this way, and I see a lot of Picassos, you know? So try to practice drawing that correctly. All right. Next. A 2 kilogram silverware drawer does not slide easily, right? You need WD-40 on that, John. The owner gradually pulls with more and more force. When applied force reaches 8 newtons, the drawer suddenly opens, throwing all the utensils on the floor. Love when that happens, especially when knife falls on your foot. Find the coefficient of static friction between the drawer and the cabinet. Fine, let's do that. All right, so here, so this is like the drawer tracks, let's say, and then here's the drawer, right, full of silverware, and of course it's sterling silver because we live in main line, right? Not one of those plated ones. So the owner, right? Not the maid, owner pulls, right, with 8 newtons of force when it starts to move, right? This is when it actually moves. But it's actually at this point it starts to move. Therefore, it is still technically, okay, at rest. And it's held by friction, right? So, of course, we have, you know, FG. And we have F normal. Now, I did not draw these in scale. But we do know, sorry, right, we do know that F normal and FG have to be the same again because there are no other vertical forces. These two are the only ones available, right? So if you want to quickly, again, do the F, sum of all forces in Y is equal to MAY, you know, sum of all forces in Y is equal to F normal plus FG, right? Right. And then if you want to say MAY is equal to F normal minus FG, right? So here AY is 0, so F normal minus MG, right? So my F normal is equal to MG, which is equal to 2 times 9.8, which is 19.6, right? So 19.6 here, 19.6 there. All right, fine, that's easy. So now, if we were to do the X direction, so sum of all forces in the X is equal to MAX, sum of all forces in the X is equal to F pull, plus friction, right? But if we set them equal to each other and give directions, right, we got F pull minus friction. But acceleration in the X is 0 at the moment because it's still not budging. So my F pull minus friction. Right. So my friction, if I bring to the other side, this should be F pull. So if I bring this negative friction to the other side of the equal sign, it becomes positive. My F friction is equal to my F pull, right, which happens to be 8 newtons. Right. So my frictional force is equal to 8 newtons. Okay? Well, my friction is also equal to mu times the F normal. So since my friction is 8 newtons, static, my F normal happens to be 19.6. So mu sub S is equal to 8.0 over 19.6. what's my u sub s equal to? Well, I get 0.408 as my u sub s. All right. Any questions so far? All right. Good, 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 good. All right. Moving along. Number six. A box is given a push so that it slides across the floor. How far will it go? Given the coefficient of kinetic friction is 0.2 and push imparts an initial speed of 4 meters per second. So you have to understand the problem, I guess. So the box was given a push. It's more like shove, right? Once it's shoved, it's no longer pushing anymore, right? So what's happening is it's going to slow down because the friction is going to act on the box horizontally only, okay? So once you push, 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 and you let go, right? It's going to be moving at 4 meters per second after you push so much and then you let go, right? It's going to start at 4 meters per second as soon as you let go, but eventually it's going to slow down, slow down, slow down, slow down to a stop because of friction. Okay? So let's draw out the scenario here. Okay. So we're going to have a box that's being shoved, right? And then eventually it's going to there's a pothole right there. I'm sorry. Alright, so here we have a box that's shoved and eventually it's going to move. And then once it moves, you stop applying the push. So only force that is applied horizontally would be friction. Okay? So what's going on? Well, here we have FG. And we have then we have F friction acting in this direction, and initial velocity of this box, the V initial happens to be 4.0 meters per second. We also know the final velocity of this is equal to zero. Here, this thing will travel from here to here. Delta X, but we don't know what the delta X is. We're going to look for that. Okay? Now, because of this friction, it will slow down. Okay? It will slow down, and then rest. Okay? So there must be deceleration happening or negative acceleration happening from this to this. Right? So what is the acceleration of the system after it's shoved, giving it 4 meters per second of initial speed? Let's figure that out first. Okay? So if we could figure that acceleration out, then we can use that acceleration as part of these three, and then we're missing fourth, right? So what is the acceleration, right? So we could figure that acceleration out using forces. So we know for here, sum of all forces in the x direction, right, is equal to max. Well, there's only one force in the x direction at the moment, and that is just the friction. So my max is equal to my frictional force, and my friction is negative because it's pointing in the negative direction. All right, so max is equal to negative mu times F normal. But what is my F normal? My F normal is just mg, because there's no other vertical forces acting on this. So I hope I don't have to rewrite that all that here, but just say that this F normal is equal to mg. All right, so this max is equal to negative, right, mu times mg. Now, here's the magic. They never told us what the mass was, but guess what? The masses cancel out very nicely. So my ax is equal to negative mu times g, or 0.2 times 9.8. Don't put negative 9.8 because we already gave direction here. So just use the positive values. So what is my acceleration? My acceleration is negative, is it 1.6, right? 1.96, right? Negative 1.96 meters per second squared. So once I know my acceleration, I can use that acceleration up here. So my acceleration is equal to negative 1.96 meters per second squared. Now I have four variables with one unknown, right? So my initial is equal to 4. My final is equal to 0. My acceleration is equal to negative 1.96. meters per second squared, and I'm looking for delta x. Looks like I have no time here, therefore maybe it's a good idea to use equation number 3. So equation number 3 states vf squared is equal to vi squared plus 2a delta x. Remember that? You thought you were done with it, didn't you? Nope. You'll be using this for a long time. So VF, 0, square that, you still get 0. VI, 4, square that, and you get 16. Oops, sorry, no, I didn't mean to do that. Right? Plus 2 times negative 1.96 times delta x. So 0 is equal to 16 minus, what's this? Right. It's negative 3.92 delta x. So if I bring this to the other side, it becomes negative. Divide that by negative 3.92, I get positive. Right. So my delta x is equal to negative 16 over negative 3.92. Therefore, my answer comes out to 4.08 meters as my answer. All right. All righty. Any questions? Next. Two crates of mass 75 kilograms and 110 kilograms are in contact and at rest on a horizontal surface. Right? As 730 newtons of force is exerted on 75 kilogram crate. If the coefficient of kinetic friction is 0.15, calculate A, the acceleration of the system, and B, the force that each crate exerts on another. B is going to be a little bit of a challenge. However, part A is not that bad. Because if you're pushing on this, both of these are going to act as one big mass of 185 kilograms, okay? So you could just look at this whole thing as if they were together as one and then find out the acceleration that way and there'll be no problem, okay? Obviously, there's going to be a resistance going this way by both of these boxes. So there's going to have to be two frictional forces happening, one by this and one by this, going in this direction, all right? So let's do a free body diagram, right, of each one of these. Well, let's treat this as one for now, for part A. Okay, so here is my two boxes, two crates. Okay, so this will have FG going down like this. This FG is equal to, you could think of it as M1 plus M2 times G. All right? Because they're going to behave as like one. Then we have F normal going this way. Right? Obviously, F normal is going to be same as this because there are no other vertical forces acting on this. Right? Then we have F push or F pull, doesn't matter, the apply force. So here's my F push, which is 730 newtons. Then there's going to be some resistance to this F push caused by frictional force, and frictional force is going to be going in this direction, opposing the direction of F push and motion. All right, so let's figure out what we can for the FG. So FG here, I get 75 plus 110 times 9.8, right? And that is 185, right? Times 9.8, and I get 1813 newtons, okay? So that's the FG. My normal force will probably be the same, right? Which is 1813 newtons. Okay. Well, can we figure out what my F friction is? My friction is equal to mu times the F normal. Therefore, mu happens to be 0.15 times F normal, which is 1813. So what's my frictional value? My frictional value is, I get 271.95 newtons for my F friction. All right. All righty then. Now what? Let's figure out what the acceleration is horizontally. So sum of all forces.
Mr. Kim?
Yeah?
Sorry, quick question. Wouldn't the force of friction be 2 times the amount we found out because there are 2 boxes?
Well, I made them into one. Yeah, so I put it together as one. So if I were to split them up, it would still add up to this, most likely, because it would be 2 different normal forces then. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. Thank you.
Yeah. All right. So now, if I were to do sum of all forces in the x direction is equal to MAX. Now, this MAX is M1 plus M2 times AX. So it's the whole system, basically, right? And then sum of all forces in the X direction, I have F push plus F friction, right? So if I set them equal to each other, right? M1 plus M2 times AX is equal to F push this. Well, I'm going to call that F push positive minus F friction. Therefore, here M1 plus M2, right? 75 plus 110 times AX is equal to F push 730 minus 271.95. So what's my AX? My AX is equal to, so 730 minus that joint, and I get 458.05. Divide that by 185. Is my AX, right? And my AX happens to be then 2.476 meters per second squared. All right. Well, this is the acceleration for both boxes. So if I were to look at the 75 kilogram box, okay, and if I were to take a look at 110 kilogram box, they will both be accelerating at this acceleration. But if I were to look at just the 110 kilogram box, right? So if I were to look at just 110 kilogram box, this box is accelerating in this direction at 476 meters per second squared. But what's pushing that? That is being pushed by 75 kilogram boxes normal force of the 70, right? F normal of 75 kilogram box onto my 110 kilogram, right? And this will be resisting, right? This will be resisting by F friction of 110 kilogram box. So this friction is definitely different than this friction. Okay? This force that's pushing this box is caused by this normal force, horizontal normal force of that 75 kilogram box. Okay? And we have, of course, Fg of 110, and we have F normal of 110, right? So they want us to figure out what this is. We can calculate this. We can calculate this. We can calculate that, right? So sum of all forces equals ma, and then sum of all forces in the x is this minus that. Set that equal to ma, and you should be able to calculate f normal 75. All right, I'm going to let you guys try that, and we'll pick that up next week, okay? I will give you one practice problem, one set of practice problem, so you can practice that over the weekend. It won't be counted as anything, but it'd be a good idea to practice it because that will be your test next week. All right? I will see you Monday from school. All right? Take care. I'll stop the lecture here.